Hello and welcome to our 5 minutes with Ekaterina Ukrainian literature. Our writer for today is Olga Kobylyanska. She is the woman who lived too early for her ideas, and according to everything she was writing, she should have lived now in present-day Ukraine and not back then in Austro-Hungarian Empire. Because she was born in 1863, at the time when the only destiny of women, according to social ideas, were to stay indoors and to care about children and her husband. And Olga was very progressive. She wanted to have education. She wanted to have her own opinion. She wanted to have her own ideas. For her, staying indoors, being just a mother and a wife, it wasn't possible at all. Secondly, because she was obsessed with the Ukrainian idea, with the idea of developing Ukrainian culture, writing in Ukrainian, and Ukrainian at the time wasn't the spoken language in the place where she was born. And certainly because she wanted the equality in discourse, she looked at the life of common people, the life of villagers, and she didn't think that the city culture should be superior to the village culture. All of these ideas, they are very normal now, and we don't even think twice before stating them. But at the time when Olga was living, they were so wild, and everybody thought that she is a strange girl. The family lived on the territory of present-day Romania when Olga was growing up. She was born in the small city near Suceava, which is now Romania. And then with the family, they moved to another city, which is also now on the territory of Romania. And only when she was in her early 20s, the whole family, they came to Chernivtsi. And Chernivtsi is the center of Bukovina region. It's an ethnographic region. Now it's partly in Moldova, partly in Romania, but most of Bukovina territory is in Ukraine, in present-day Ukraine. And despite in the family of Olga, they spoke Ukrainian because the father was the descendant of a noble Kazakh family. And the mother was German-Polish origin, but the mother learned Ukrainian and tried to speak with children in Ukrainian only. Outside of the house, people didn't use Ukrainian language. The official language in the empire was German, and when Olga went to school, she learned how to write and read in German, and she knew German language perfectly. And also Hungarian language was common, Romanian language was common, but Ukrainian language wasn't common. It was the language of not educated people in the villages, in this territory again. And Chernivtsi, it wasn't the center of Ukrainian cultural movement at all. At the time in Austro-Hungary, it was Lviv and Vienna, and under the Russian Empire, it was of course Kyiv. But for Chernivtsi, it wasn't common to use Ukrainian language and to write in Ukrainian, moreover, to write in Ukrainian. Olga started to write her novels very early, but she wrote them in German and publishing them in different German magazines. And when under the influence of her friends, she started to write in Ukrainian. Firstly, she was translated. She was writing it in German and then translated it to Ukrainian. And she tried to publish it in the magazine, which editor of which was Ivan Franko, another famous Ukrainian writer. He refused her. He said that no, it's very poorly written. And we still don't know if it was really because it was not the proper language, poorly written, or Ivan Franko didn't want to accept something with so progressive ideas. Because the center of the novel was a woman. A woman with her own thoughts, a woman who wanted to learn something, who wanted to be educated, who had her political ideas even, which was impossible at the time. And she struggled a little bit. Actually, she did rewrite it into German. She translated it into German and sent it to a German magazine. They said that it's too long, so it wasn't published at the time. And it was the base of her other biggest novel she will write long, long years after. And she not only was writing about feminist ideas and how equal women should be to men, she was living like that. She wanted to marry, and she had some men in her life whom she loved wholeheartedly, but they didn't want to accept her as their wives because for them she was too wild. It was like, no, I wouldn't marry her, that's impossible. And the only fun for her at the time was doing her writings, first writing and publishing her small novels. Let's read the part of the novel in which all characters are women. Like nowadays, we even have the test checking if the movie is okay, if there are women there who are talking to each other, who all have names. So in this piece of writing belonging to early 20th century, is everything is there. So there were three women talking to each other, acting, having their own feelings, and all of them saw the different, all of them had the different views on what's going on and how they should live. It wasn't like that feminists should be only in politics or to enter the university. Some of them wanted to be mothers, one of them wanted to be mother. And Olga is not judging them. It's okay. It's okay as soon as the woman has a choice. And this is the choice she wanted, not really the all destiny for everybody. Which we should actually, in modern times, our feminists should learn it from her, probably. Let's read together the piece of her relatively early novel called Вальс меланхолік.
Не можу слухати меланхолійної музики. А вже найменше такої, що приваблює зразу душу ясними, до танцю визиваючими граціозними звуками. А відтак, зрікаючися їх незамітно, лється лише одною широкою струєю смутку. Я розпадаюся тоді вчуття і не можу опертися настроєві сумному, мов креповий флер, якого позбутися мені не так легко. Зате, як проснеться музика близьку, я подвійно живу. Обнімала би тоді цілий світ, заявляючи далеко-широко, що музика грає. І класичну музику люблю. Навчила мене її розуміти і відгадувати по мотивах одна з моїх товаришок, якої душа немов складалася з тонів і була сама олицетворена музика. Вона вічно шукала гармонії. В людях, в її відчуванні, в їх відносинах до себе і до природи.
Firstly, the whole writings of Olga were concentrated on women's destiny, and they were mostly the translation of her thoughts influenced by German literature, which she knew much better than the local literature. But at some point she understood that she cannot do a good writings without knowing the local language, knowing the local culture, and knowing what inheritance this culture has in it. That's how she started to write, she started to know the Ukrainian writers at the time, and she firstly started to be writing friends, pen friends with Lesya Ukrainka, and then they finally met in 1899 when Olga went to Kyiv to the archaeological conference. From this conference she went to Gadech, near which there was a home of Lesya Ukrainka, and they met in person and they had a friendship. They influenced, they helped each other because they were both women trying to write something in the man masculine environment, and they became a good friends for a long time. Gradually, under influence of this Ukrainian discourse, which at the time was mostly about social ideas and about the way society should live, Olga is going a little bit out of feminist topic and writing your most famous, mostly famous novels, which now are part of the program of Ukrainian literature for children, which we learn at school. And this one is called Zemlya, Earth, and it tells about two brothers. One of them kills each other because the father didn't give him the part of the family property. And this one is reflecting the normal pathway, it's reflecting socialist idea, it's reflecting the ideas of how poor people are. And also in this novel, their main characters are men, as it was usual, habitual in the literature of the time. But if you look at female characters in it, you will see that they're even more independent, even more smart, and they can go through the misfortunes in life more easily than men. Let's read the part of it, a very small one, just to get into idea, to get into writing.
2 години від ріки Серету на Буковині лежить село Де. Його рівні поля пригадували б степ, якби не те, що місяцями вони западають, мов знеохочені своїм положенням, творячи плиткі невеликі кітли. І якби не той великий ліс, що тягнеться по західній стороні села і творить зелений мур поперек широкої площини, щоб обмежити її розмах. Пишний, майже безмежний великан, неначе у вандрівці, задержався ось тут та задумався над тихими полями. А недалеко нього, почувши за собою зеленого опікуна, попіднімалися сільські хати. Тут і там розкинулося село. Ліс панський, власність приватна. Тонкі ніжні берези попереплеталися з поважними дубами і ясними літніми ночами блистять, мов у срібло одягнені. Їх листя дрижить неспокійно, а граціозні, легко повигинані пні приманюють до себе ніжністю та білістю, мов русалки.
I think this piece only will prove that Olga had a very good feeling of Ukrainian word and all this poor quality of her writings, things that men were saying for her, they were just excuses in order not to publish what she was saying. Anyway, her life was long. She lived 76 years and she died in 1942. So she saw how the new empires emerged on the previous empires. She always was a citizen officially, firstly of Austro-Hungary and then of Romania. She never was the part of Ukraine. And she lived through the revolutions and wars. Her writings, they reflect her ideas and they reflect something which was much, much better than the time she was living in, and it was a prediction or maybe the creation of the modern world we see now. Tell me what you think about it. Tell me what you think if the woman at the time, if it was a good idea to become so progressive so openly, or if there were any other way to free the women and to get into society we have now. And also tell me your ideas about society, maybe. I'm waiting for a comment below the video. Don't forget about your likes if you like it. And if you can, please support me on Patreon. Thank you, my dear patrons, for all your help. That motivates me so much to create more of these videos. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope to see you very soon. Goodbye.